French factory here. Right? If it turns out well, you can thank him. If it doesn't turn out well, then you have my permission to do something to them. All right. You know, today, for those of you guys who are new, there are a few people who are leaving our group, our community. They've been here with us for a while, and now they're leaving. And so that's why I titled the message, When We Say Goodbye. And it made me think about when we do say goodbye, we want to kind of leave on a good note, don't we? Wherever we leave, we want to kind of leave a nice fragrance. We don't want to leave an odor when we leave. We want to make a good impression. We want to make a difference where we were. And that's what I want to talk to you today about. How can we live in a way, in community, at work, at school, in our families, at church, wherever we are, in a group, how can we live in a way when we make, when we can make a positive difference of where we were, so that when we leave, it's better than when we first got there. It's better than when we first got there. And in the passage that we read earlier, we see a man by the name of Paul. And he spent 3 years in a place called Ephesus, and he did ministry there. And he's meeting with the people there for the last time, and the people don't know that. People don't know that they're going to see him for the last time. And so he's on his way to Jerusalem, because God has given him a mission to go to Jerusalem, and he has to get there in a hurry, so he can't stop by Ephesus to say goodbye to his people. So he calls the people to where he is in Miletus, and he's about to give him his last words. His last words. And in his last words, he tells us how he lived there. And that's what we're going to look at. We're going to look at how did he live in such a way so as to call the people to him, and they would all come, okay? And when he said, this is my last time I'm going to see you, what did they do? The last verse, they wept aloud. They wept aloud, they embraced him, and they kissed him repeatedly, crying, repeatedly. Kissing is a way of saying goodbye in that culture. So they couldn't say goodbye enough. They're like, don't go, don't go. And Paul's like, that's enough, man, stop, stop. Bro, that's enough. Get rid of your stuff, right? And then the Bible says they accompanied him to the ship, right? And we do that a lot, like for people who are close to us, right? We don't want to say goodbye. And, you know, especially Koreans, they just keep on bowing, bowing. I'm like, that's enough, right? I'm like, man, it's enough of bowing, you know? And so, yeah, we take them out to the car, and we start waving. You know, we don't stop waving until we see them out of our sight for those who are close to us. And that's what's happening to Paul here. How many years did he spend in Ephesus? 3 years, 3.5 years. That's not a lot of time. That's not a lot of time. Okay? And within 3.5 years, how did Paul live? Let me summarize it for you. We're going to go into it in more detail. Number one, he gave his life fully. He poured out his life fully there. He didn't hold anything back. Another way of putting it is, he committed himself. He made a commitment to serving God and serving the people. So if we want to make a difference where we are, we need to commit ourselves and give ourselves fully. We need to be a giver and not a taker. Okay? Now, in every organization, yeah, give with your sneezes, all right, just cover it up. In every organization, there are three types of people: givers, takers, and matchers, okay? So the givers are those who sacrifice their time, right? They help those who are in need. They don't ask for anything back. They don't ask for recognition. They're always giving. The takers are those who go there for their own gain, for their own selfish gain. They look out only for themselves. They want to be promoted. They want to, you know, they're there for themselves. They take. The matchers, they're those, they give only when there's a return, okay? So they're about like give and take, right? I give some, you give me some, all right? Give me some and I'll give you some. It's like, those are the matchers, okay? So for those who are takers and matchers, there is no impact where they are. It's the giver who gives the impact, okay? Now you may say, okay, the takers and the matchers, well, that's a fair way to live, you know? We gotta make it, we gotta survive. It's a fair way, it's a just way, but if you give some, only when you take some, you don't make the kind of impact. The kind of impact requires a full commitment. We give wherever we go, okay? So committed people, they make wherever they go that place better, okay? So what does a committed person look like? Number one, consistency. Consistency, okay? You're there when things are tough. You know, in this English ministry, there's about right now about 40 people. There was a time when there was like four. And the four were the piano player, the bass player, the preacher, and the guy who's standing out there, you know? But there were consistent people who stuck through it, and look at it now. Okay? Of course, you have a, you know, tall, dark, handsome pastor standing in front of you. That's one reason. But they were consistent. And I remember when I was growing up, there was a pastor who told me, you know what encourages me the most? That person who comes every Sunday and sits in the same place over and over. That's so encouraging. I was like, really? They don't have to do anything? No, they just have to sit there like a log? Yeah. And now, being a pastor, I know what he means. And when I look among the crowd and I see that same person just sitting there consistently, you know, he's there always. It's so encouraging. And there are some of you guys who are here like that. You're consistent. You're committed. You keep coming, and so I keep coming. And if you don't come, I don't come. That's the way it works. And some of you guys who stuck through it, those dark and lonely times, right? Four people. You know? Look how faithful God was. Bet you didn't see this coming, right? Look how faithful God was. And committed people, they make a difference. Consistency. Another aspect of being committed is you don't hold back where you are. Give it your all. Paul here is described by the person who's writing about Paul, which is Luke in the book of Acts. And there's a word that he used, the phrase that he uses to describe it. He uses it twice, and he says that Paul did not shrink back. He did not shrink back. I'll read verse 18 and 19 and 20. Paul speaking says, he's speaking to the elders who he has called, and he says this, "You yourselves know from the first day I set foot in Asia how I was with you the whole time, serving the Lord with humility and with tears and with trials which came upon me through the plots of the Jews. How I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable." So what he's saying was, from the day that I set foot in Asia, I was with you, you saw. I was serving you with humility and tears because it was trials. There was plots that was, you know, to take my life. But I didn't shrink back, did I? I didn't shrink back. I gave it my all, didn't I? Right? And Paul is telling the elders, remember how I gave it all for the church and for you. And I want you to do that. To preserve the church, because I'm not going to see you anymore, and there's no one who's going to take care of the church except you. You're it, right? Look at the way I lived. I gave it my all. When it was hard, I didn't shrink back, okay? And in another verse 27, he says, "For I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole purpose of God." And Paul says, you know, I did my best. I'm innocent. I gave it my all. So wherever you go, okay, for those who you're... For those of you guys who are living, wherever you go, you gotta don't hold back. You gotta give it your all. You gotta make a commitment to that place. You know what that takes? It takes an open heart. The problem with us when we are at a place, we're just kind of there, you know, we're just kind of spectator, our hearts are not open, you see. It's kind of closed because we're afraid that if I give it my all, okay, I'm just going to be spent. There's going to be nothing in return. I don't want to be hurt, right? I don't want to be taken advantage of. And we hold ourselves back. It takes an open heart. When you go to a place, when you're with the team, at work or school, at church, you need to open your heart and trust God. And you have to open your heart. I mean, and until you open your heart to the people and the organization, you're not going to experience what God can do in your life. You're not going to experience it. You're not going to be committed to it. You're not going to be consistent. There's always going to be something you're holding back for yourself. You see? And I told you before, takers and matchers, they don't make a difference. But God wants you to make a difference. You need to open your heart. And let me share a little experience. I'm telling you guys this from experience. When I went to college, I was a freshman. I was very proud and very selfish. Those two things keep you from opening your heart. Your selfishness and your pride. Okay? That's who I was. And so I told you guys that, you know, I was at the computer science hall dorm, right? Some of you guys know. And you know about computer science majors. They're a little, not as, I don't know, I better be careful because there may be some computer science majors here. But, you know, they're not that outgoing. They usually have glasses, at least back then. They just look kind of weird. I don't know, just not the kind of crowd that you want to be seen with, you know? Kind of like, you guys know that TV show, right? With the Big Bang Theory. There you go. The Big Bang Theory, right? It's just like the Big Bang Theory. My hall was a Big Bang Theory cast right there, right? And so I'm like, no. And actually, they were all trying to, you know, be friendly. I'm like, oh my gosh, why did I major in computer science? I switched dorms to like the party dorm. And I experienced a kind of loneliness because I distanced myself from, you know, from the people, right? There was a sense of loneliness and, you know, and now I was in a hall where now I was a nerd, right? And all the cool guys didn't hang out with me, right? I was like, man. So this is how it feels to be a nerd, right? And then the next semester, following semester, God was working in my heart. In that dorm, a Christian guy, he was valedictorian of his school. He was about 6 foot tall. He was the high school starting quarterback. He was the first seed in his tennis team. And he was a Christian, you know, and he played the guitar, played volleyball. And he saw me in passing. I kind of introduced him through a friend of mine, and he befriended me. This cool guy is befriending a nerd like me, you know? I was like, wow, this is something, you know? And God began to reveal some stuff in my heart, the pride, you know, how I treated, you know, the Big Bang Theory cast, the game, and the other tour. I was like, wow. And then, that Big Bang Theory cast visited me in my dorm, in my new place. There was a knock on my door, I was like, what could this be? It's either that Christian guy, or I don't know who else. And it was this Big Bang Theory cat. I was like, hey, Big Bang Theory cat, what are you doing here? They're like, hey, we want to welcome you. I mean, we wanted to, you know, kind of visit you in a new semester, you know, welcome you so you can have a good start. So I was like, man, showing me kindness. You know, after I ditched them, it's like, man, after that, I felt so bad. I was like, Jin, you're such a loser. You're such a jerk, man. How can you be so prideful? You know, you're nothing. And then that's when I opened my heart. And I went back to the Big Bang Theory. And I became part of the Big Bang Theory. And I committed myself to become a Big Bang theorist. Bona fide, nerd and all. But when I got to know them, they weren't nerds at all. coolest people. The nicest, kindest, coolest, cleanest, you know, the most good people that I can meet. And we developed such a close friendship, you know. And I used to, you know, go visit them. And, you know, almost every day, and there's like, Jen, stop now. We became so tight, you know, like the TV show Friends. But that all started when I had to let go of my pride, you know, open my heart, become vulnerable, and say, hey, I want to be your friend. Commitment requires that we give it all. We need to open our hearts to the group that we're in, and then we'll experience something. Okay? You won't be alone anymore. I know there's some lonely guys and girls in here. Y'all need to open your heart. Y'all need friends. We need to open our hearts. And God will use you like Paul. And Paul, he had opened his heart. Another thing that we need, that Paul had, besides opening our hearts, in order for us to commit, commitment requires a cause. Okay? Not only do you commit to a group or a people, you commit to a cause. Bill Hybels calls this the white hot why. White because it's so crystal clear. Hot because it makes you hot, you know, like you're passionate about it. And the why is the cause. You need a white hot why in your life. And some of us, we're not committed to anything because we don't have the white hot why. You see? Paul had the white hot why. He was willing to die for it. And that's why he gave it his all. He was committed. He gave fully. He was a giver because he had a cause. And what does Paul say? He says that, okay, I'm going to Jerusalem. Guys, I'm going to Jerusalem. And I know God is telling me there's only affliction there. They're going to persecute me there. I'm in bonds. They're going to put me in prison, etc., etc. And that's what happens, actually. But he's telling the elders, I know there's affliction there, but I have to go there. Why? Because my life means nothing if I don't fulfill the cause for which Jesus has called me to. Do you have a cause that you're living for? That you're willing to die for? And that's why we like to watch those movies, right? Where everyone's like, Braveheart. Man, all the guys love that movie, Braveheart, right? There's that speech when Mel Gibson rides the horse. They're about to fight the English army, you know? Will you give this? I already told you guys. Will you, you know, trade this one day for the moment to prove that, you know, whatever? And then there's something about a cause. Do you have that white hot why? I want to share with you my white hot why these days. You know, we just announced Awana. You know, I told you the announcements. Awana. Awana stands for approved workers are not ashamed. Okay, approved workers are not ashamed. So if you're approved, if you're ready, if you're approved, a worker of God, if you're equipped, you will not be ashamed. Okay? And it's about equipping children to become godly, to know, to love, and to serve Jesus. It's getting them while they're young, right? Training them how to love and giving them a vision. Okay? Now, that's my white hot why. But I want to explain to you why it is so you can discover your white hot why. Okay? Now, I'm passionate about letting people know about Jesus because he changed my life. I told you a little bit about how he changed my heart. It was much more than that. You know, I was in a place where there was no hope. Okay? There was no meaning. Nothing to live for. The only thing to live for was this money, right? Pleasure and power, which is the only thing that the world offers. That meant nothing to me. But Jesus changed my life. And I know for people who don't know God, they need Jesus Christ. I know that. Because Jesus can make your life fuller. And so I like to share the gospel. That's my passion. That people will be transformed by Christ. They would meet Christ face to face, heart to heart, and experience the joy and the love that God offers. And that's what Awana is about. Okay? The goal of Awana is for every participating child to know, to love, and to serve Jesus. Secondly, I'm all about efficiency. Okay? I have, whenever I work and do something, it has to be efficient. I don't like to waste time. I don't like to waste money or fuel. For example, like when I drive, right? I'm one of those people who cruise to a stop. I don't brake to a stop. I cruise to a stop to conserve fuel. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I feel sorry for those who are driving behind me. Because when I see like a stop sign, like a mile ahead, I'm already stopping. And one of my goals is actually to cruise to a stop, like right at the stop sign or the stop light, you know? I've almost gotten there, you know? You can't do it on a flat ground, but you can do it kind of when it's like an incline. Because the incline kind of helps you out, right? So when I see a red light, my foot comes off the pedal, I'm cruising. I'm like, yeah, I'm saving gas. All I'm thinking, I'm saving gas. Yeah, all you fools, you guys got, you know, you're wasting fuel. I'm saving gas. So I'm all like efficiency, right? And so I got to know about this Awana, and this Awana, that's what, you know, one of the philosophies of Awana is that the kids are most sensitive and vulnerable to form and mold at the ages between 5 and 12. Okay? Ages between 5 and 12. And so they're very strategic, okay? And so it's like, wow, you know, they really thought through this out. And studies have shown that kids who participated in Awana for several years are 3.5 times more likely to read their Bible several times a week, right? How many of you guys don't read your Bible several times a week? Raise your hand. Yeah, y'all need to go to Awana. See, you needed Awana. And those who went through Awana, the alumni, show that 92%, they go to church weekly or more than twice, right? And 70% share their faith to their friends once a month. How many of you guys share your faith with your friends once a month? Oh, okay. One. Wow, what? Man, good. Did you guys go to Awana? All you. Yeah, it's like 1% here. So Awana is very efficient and strategic. Thirdly, I like to have fun. That's my personality. In everything that I do, I like to have fun. Too much fun. And that kind of gets me into trouble, especially when I'm preaching. And I talk about a lot of stupid things, but it's for you guys. And I want us to have fun in our faith. Awana is fun. It's about games. There's a lot of games. I was watching a video. I'm like, man, they're having so much fun. I want to do that. I'm going to incorporate some of that for the retreat that's coming up. You know, sign up back there, okay, after service for the retreat if you're going. I'm all about fun. Awana is fun. Fourthly, I like to know that whatever I commit to has eternal value and lasting impact. And that's what Awana is about. It's about shaping the future and the eternal destinies of children. And lastly, I like to know that what I commit myself to, there's a potential for success. And I'm actually kind of anal about that. And I don't think I have a lot of faith. People think that I have faith, but before I go somewhere, research so much on the internet, and my wife gets so ticked off about that, you know, every little thing, you know, and I compare like 30 hotels, right, I compare all the things, whatever they offer, and it takes me, I planned my own honeymoon to Bali. I was so tired after, I was like, I don't want to go. I've seen, experienced everything about Bali, I don't want to go there anymore. Alright, I know exactly what's there, I've experienced it. Honey, you go, tell me how it was, and let's share, and if you agree. Right, that's how it was. So, but Awana started in 1950 with two pastors who saw a line of children outside of a movie theater, and they said, how can we get a line outside our church just as there's a line here in the movie theater, right? And they came up with a way of games, rewarding children. I brought it. Okay? The This is a vest for the K to two guys. Thank you. And then they, when they do well, right? They prove themselves to be like a leader. They get one of these. It's amazing what this could do to guys. All right. So there's blue and red ones. Not only that, here you put like little diamonds in there. Yeah. By the way, you can sign up afterwards today if you're interested. Doesn't mean you're gonna do anything, but we're gonna have an informational meeting on September 12th. And so this is for the K-2. This is for the preschoolers. And they get more cutesy with the littler guys. They get this apple seed thing, And they get little apples whenever they memorize verses. They're easy verses, like three words. See? And this is for, let me check out your IQs. Why do you think this book is so long like this? This is for the preschoolers. Anybody? Teachers. You see, you have a heart for kids. Okay. So this is a kid for, this is a book for 3 and 4 year olds, and it's so that the parents can sit with the kid and watch it together, read it together like this, And that they thought about everything. And I just read this and I was like, wow, so good how they just, A is for all. Can you find anything else that starts with the A? This is good stuff. If you're a parent, you got to bring your kids, or even participate in it. Let me show you guys the other books. This is the TNT for 3 and 6 graders. This is the hang glider, the K-2 books, right? I don't know why the books get smaller as they get older. Actually, they should make the books bigger because, our eyes has, see today, prove that. All right, so we need a cause, right? We need to discover what is it that moves us. I just shared it to you. Right now, it's a one. By the way, our EM, right, and Awana, we're like this now, right? Just to let you know. If you want to be a part of the EM, somehow you got to be at least praying for it. You know why? We're talking about how to make a difference where we are, right? As far as English ministry in a big Korean church, what is our contribution? Have you thought about it? Over there, they're like, oh, we're just, worshiping there. No. We need to make a contribution to the church, right? You know why? Because they're supporting me, right? I'm just kidding. And this is something that we, as English speakers, can do for them and the community around here, okay? This is actually for the children in this community, right? So if you like to have fun with kids, I wish I would have brought that video of the kids playing that Olympic Awana games, but now how do you discover your cause? You gotta discover your shape, right? And the shape, God created you with a certain shape. Now, the shape is an acrostic that stands for spiritual gifts. Okay? And spiritual gift includes like leadership, giving, evangelism, teaching, etc. Okay? That's the S. H stands for your heart. Okay, what are you passionate about? Okay? What moves you? Okay? Do orphans move you? Okay? Do people, children, right? Helping them, what kind of heart do you have, right? Music, right? Some people have, your heart is all about music. Some of you guys are all about missions. Your heart, okay? So S, spiritual gift. H, heart. A is your ability. God's given you a certain ability. Some of you guys can do you guys are like high-techy stuff people, right? The Big Bang Theory. Cat, no, I'm just kidding. Oh, I stopped there, right? So we need help with that, right? And so some of you guys are like more creative, right? Some of you guys can dance and drama. And I want to put some of that up here, Anybody like dance? Drama? Okay. So some of you guys have like certain abilities of planning and organizing, administrative stuff, you need that. So spiritual gift, your heart and your abilities, peace, personality. Some of you guys are like outgoing, you're all out there, right? I'm extrovert too. Some of you guys are more introspective, right? More quiet, but you guys can think and kind of think a little bit deeper, right? You need those personalities. And E is for your experience, okay? The kind of experience God has given you in your life that you can use, right? To help people and make a difference where you are. Now, how can you discover your shape? You have to commit. No other way. There's no way to discover who you are if you're just in the sidelines, just watching everybody do their thing. You gotta commit. You gotta become active. You gotta volunteer. And you gotta serve. And you have to become a part of something. And then through experience, you discover who you are. You learn more about your shape. Okay? And once you do that, God begins to give you opportunities to live for a cause. The last part that I want to talk about in terms of making a difference, the first thing is you need to make a commitment. Give yourself fully where you are. Secondly, be a giver. Okay? Not a taker. Okay? Give. Be on the side of giving. Givers make a group better. And Paul was a giver. He preached the gospel publicly, privately, to the Jews, to the Greeks, day and night. And it says that in verse 33, 34, he says this, I have coveted no one's silver, gold, or clothes. You yourselves know that these hands minister to my own needs and to the men who are with me, which means no one paid them to do ministry. He worked. And he supported himself. Okay? And he says in verse 35, In everything, I showed you that by working hard in this manner, you must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he himself said. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Guys, when you give, you will receive far more than what you think you're losing. There was a study done on individual performance of givers, takers, and matchers. Okay? I told you guys, right? They did a test on the performance. They looked at the productivity of engineers. They looked at the grades of medical students. And they looked at the revenue of salespeople. Okay? Who do you think performed the lowest? Who thinks it's takers? Raise your hand. Who thinks it was the matchers? Raise your hand. Who thinks it was the givers? Raise your hand. None of you guys just have no clue what I just said. Or you're just too tired. I'm like, I ain't gonna raise my hand. I ain't committed yet. Shoot, my heart's closed. You gotta open my heart. So some of you guys have open hearts? Okay, no. The givers perform the worst across all. They had the less productivity among the engineers. They had the lowest grades. They had the least amount of revenue among the salespeople. Why? Because they're busy helping other people. But they're like one of those, you know, they fail to put on their mask before helping others. They're those kind of people, right? Let me ask you. And there's a good example. Okay, so there's a lady by the name of Kat Cole. Anybody know Kat Cole? Okay. So she's a classic giver. At the age of 15, she got two jobs, selling clothes, serving food, you know. And then at serving food one day, the chef doesn't show up. Who's the first person at the kitchen? She's there. That's not her job, but she's there, just cooking, right? And then the next day, the manager gets sick, doesn't show up. Who does all the organizing and the times tables? It's Kat. She's doing that. Now, this is when she was 15. She finally gets to college. Good news, right? Wrong. Bad news. She drops out of college. She fails in all of her classes because she's too busy taking the load of other people at her work, right? Now, let me tell you. So when she dropped out, She didn't stay there. Okay? Let me ask you guys another question. Who do you think is the highest performers? The good news is not the takers. Okay? The highest performers is not the takers. And the reason why is because the matchers, you know, they're very just people, right? Give and take. And they pinfall a taker. They want to take out the taker. And who also takes out a taker? Other takers. They want to be the only takers, right? They try out the company. The takers are not the highest performers. It's not the matchers. Highest performers are also the givers. Well, how can that be? Because there's a bell curve. The lowest 25% are the givers, and also the highest 25% of high performers are givers too. On the short run, the givers, they lose out. But in the long run, the givers, they're the top performers. Okay? Why? Let me give you an example through Catcole. So what happens with Catcole? So there's an opening for an international branch for her company. Okay? She applies through a suggestion of her manager. Okay? But then Catcole says, no, I'm not qualified. I don't have a degree. You know, I'm less qualified than the other guys. Right? But her manager encourages her. She gets accepted for the position, okay? And then they call her to open another restaurant in Africa, in Australia. At 26 years of age, she becomes the corporate training leader. 32 years old, she becomes the president of the company, Cinnabon. You guys know that? Cinnabon? She's the president, 32 years old. How can she do this? Because she was giving. And while she was giving, she was gaining all that experience. She was the only one who knew how to run the company all by herself. She could run it. She knew how to cook. She knew how to manage time, right? She knew how to serve and all that. Givers outperform in the long run, you see. And so as a giver, not only do you make a positive difference, you gain yourself. But in order to give, there is an ingredient, okay? And that ingredient is love. Love, okay? They interviewed a guy, and he sold trucks, and he was one of the guys who scored the highest in the survey regarding the giver thing. He was a real high giver. But his sales was the lowest. It was like, what's going on, right? So I interviewed him and said, what? You know, what's the cost of your generosity? You know, what's going on here? And he says, I love the customer so much. I don't want to sell him or her one of our, you know, worst products. I can't make myself to sell them one of our worst products, right? So he doesn't sell. And so he has compassion for people. He cares for people and he loves for people. And in order for you to be a giver, you need love. And we know that famous passage, for God so loved the world, that he gave. And I want to close with this poem. You guys probably heard of it, and maybe even read it, called The Giving Tree. The Giving Tree. Okay? And once there was a tree. She loved a little boy. Every day the boy would come and he would gather her leaves and make them into crowns and play king of the forest. He would climb up her trunk and swing from her branches and eat apples. And they would play hide and go seek, and when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree very much, and the tree was happy. But the time went by, and the boy grew older, and the tree was often alone. Then one day, the boy came to the tree, and the tree said, come, boy, come and climb up my trunk, swing from my branches, and eat my apples, and play in the shade and be happy. I'm too big to climb and play, said the boy. I want to buy things. I want to have fun. I want some money. I'm sorry, said the tree, but I have no money. I have only leaves and apples. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city. Then you will have money and you will be happy. So the boy climbed up the tree, gathered her apples, and carried them away. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time, and the tree was sad. And then one day, the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy. And she said, "Come, boy, climb up my trunk and sweep from my branches and be happy." "I'm too busy to climb trees," said the boy. "I want a house to keep me warm." He said, "I want a wife and I want children, so I need a house. Can you give me a house?" "I have no house," said the tree. "The forest is my house, but you may cut off my branches and build a house. Then you will be happy." And so the boy cut off her branches and carried them away to build his house. And the tree was happy. But the boy stayed away for a long time. And when he came back, the tree was so happy. She could hardly speak. "Come, boy," she whispered. "Come and play." "I am too old and sad to play," said the boy. "I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat?" "Cut down my trunk and make a boat," said the tree. "Then you can sail away and be happy." So the boy cut down her trunk, made a boat, and sailed away, and the tree was happy. But not really. And after a long time, the boy came back again. "I am sorry, boy," said the tree. "I have nothing left to give you. My apples are gone. My teeth are too weak for apples," said the boy. "My branches are gone," said the tree. "You cannot swing on them." "I'm too old to swing on the branches," said the boy. "My trunk is gone," said the tree. "You cannot climb." "I'm too tired to climb," said the boy. "I'm sorry," sighed the tree. "I wish that I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I am just an old stump. I'm sorry. I don't need very much now," said the boy. "Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I'm very tired." "Well," said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could. "Well, an old stump is good for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit down. Sit down and rest." And the boy did, and the tree was happy. This story reminds me, if we have love, there's always something to give. There's always something to give. Don't ever think that you have nothing to give. Rather, think about Christ and how he gave so that we can be happy, we can have joy and have eternal life. And fill your heart with love. When you have love, there's always something to give. For those of you guys who are going away, remember the gospel of God and the love that God has shown you. And with that, give your life fully to the people who you meet. You'll make a difference. Commit yourself. You'll make a difference. Now, I was talking to SC, who's going away to Vancouver, and I found out he's been here for 40 years. 40 years. That's as old as the church. So he's like history. He's like literally ancient history. And I prepared Ben, but do take him with you if you can. I prepared a few slides and pictures that we could see and remember him by, okay? So, John, can you